how's everybody this morning?
Yes.
Good, good, good. You know, I was sitting in the back and I was just thinking, you know, isn't the Lord cool? I mean, isn't he really good?
Yes.
He's been so good to us. You know, think about it. I mean, there are so many people around the world that are just going through hell and high water itself, you know? I mean, no food, no water, no shelter, and yet we got all this goodness and mercy and kindness stirring up right here in this house and in America, and just how blessed we are. But we don't want to get so hung on that, because really the main attraction for us is Jesus Christ, amen? The main attraction for us is, you know, living the life and being a light wherever we go, amen? And letting Jesus just shine through us, you know? And we've been talking about revival, church. We've been talking about revival. And let me just say this, too. You know, when the ministers, whether it be me or pastor or whoever is up here, please pray for them. Because the warfare that it takes to get the word sometimes is not easy. I'm just telling you the truth. The warfare to dig and to get these scriptures and to get these revelations are not easy. And then to have to come up here and then convey the truth. Of course, it's the Holy Spirit, but we have to do our part. And our part is getting into this word and doing our part to study, so on and so forth. So we've been talking about revival, and Rachel, I love the songs. They were right on point, sis. Revival, real revival. What is revival? And is our hearts ready, really, truly ready to see the power of God move? I don't know if you've ever been in an atmosphere where you've really sensed such a supernatural presence of the Lord, but I'm going to explain this real quick and then we're going to get into it. I remember one time I went to a youth conference several years ago, and the Spirit of the Lord just told me, the Lord says, I'm going to let my presence fall in this auditorium. So we went to the youth conference, and I mean, I don't even know how many people were there. Thousands of people were there. And the worship team went, the man preached, and then the worship team came back up. And I said, well, maybe I thought I heard wrong. Maybe, you know, sometimes we hear wrong, you know, I can admit to that. But all of the sudden, the power of God just hit that place. And I'm telling you, everybody in the stadium hit the floor. I mean, I felt like I wanted to crawl up under the bleachers because the power of God was so heavy, and you knew it. You knew it when he was there, because, I mean, you know, when our Father steps in on the scene, you know, it's not going to be unnoticeable, that's for sure. You know, but the power of God fell, and I never forgotten that. And there's been pockets, I'm sure every one of us may have experienced God like that. But in this final hour, guys, in this final term, God is wanting to do something so unreal through his people. See, God don't really need us, but thank God that he needs us. Amen. Thank God that he's willing to use every one of us if we are willing. If we are willing. We just said it a little earlier. Blessed are those who hunger and thirst for righteousness, for they shall be filled. So are you ready to be filled today? Are we ready to hear the word today? Let's set aside everything else and let's focus on what we came here to focus on and get what we came here to get, so that we can be the kind of people whom God wants us to be. Amen?
Amen.
So let's roll. Let me pray. Father, in the name of Jesus, I thank you for this day. I thank you for this time, Lord. Thank you, Lord, that your word says that where two or more are gathered, you are right here in the midst, Father. Lord, we are saying this morning that our hearts are ready, that we desire, Father God. As Pastor said, yes, Lord, you see all of our faults, me included, Lord. You see through all of us, Father God. There's nothing, the word said, there's nothing hidden in your sight, Father. So that's why we come this morning, Father God, with an open heart and with outstretched arms raised to heaven, saying, Lord, have your will, not my will, but your will be done, Father God, in these earthen vessels as it already is in heaven, Father God. Lord, have your way in this house. Lord, have your way in our hearts, Lord, because we want to be more like you, Father God. We bless you, Lord. And I'm so thankful that you're so real, Father God. You're so real to me, and you're making yourself more and more real to me and to us each and every day, Father God. So, Lord, we plead the blood. We thank you that the air is clean, that our hearts are clear, and we're ready to receive, Father God, what you want to say in Jesus' name, and all God's people say.
Amen.
All right, well, you can go ahead and put that first picture up on the board there. And remember, folks, last week we talked about a new year, a new ear, and a new heart. And this is what we call the groundworks. This is where we're going to focus on today, guys. You know, we talked about the Great Awakening and what the Great Awakening was and how revivals came out of the Great Awakening. And out of the revivals came Christian, the importance of Christian education. Thank God for that and how important Christian education is. And now as we're moving on, again, I want to focus real quickly on a new year, a new ear, and a new heart. And we're just going to concentrate on the ear, the heart, and the ear. I think I just said that. I'm sorry. Y'all just pray for me, because like I said, this what I'm getting ready to talk about, it's a little, I'm going to just go ahead and it might be a little choppy to your spirit, okay? But love me, because I'm not here to condemn anybody. I'm not here to throw anybody up under the bus. You know, but if God is trying to get something to us, then we ought to listen and see what God is trying to say and then take that and then apply it to our lives. Amen. Okay, so the next picture, Will. And as we broke down there, the word heart, we talked about the ear, we talked about hearing, and then we talked about the heart. And then last week we talked about we can't just be a hearer of the word, but we have to become an active listener of the word. That means that when I'm engaged and I'm participating with the word, then something is going to happen. Something is going to kick in, and something is going to change within the depths of my heart. Amen. And that's what we want. And that's what God wants. And that's why he created us. And I'm so thankful that God is so awesome in our lives that he's willing to get whatever word he needs to us. Because how can I grow? How can I be effective? How can I do his will if I'm not hearing his word and I'm not allowing that word to do anything? But I have to be an active participant and work with the word, amen? I got to work with this thing, okay? So if we're talking about revival, and the word revival means to awaken, to arouse, to live again, so we have to make it personal, but then we have to make it corporate, amen, church? And corporate revival must actively be engaged within our hearts, within our hearing, and our ears, amen. Amen, amen, amen. Now, can you put up there Matthew 13 and 9? Matthew 13 and 9. Thank you, Lord. Okay? Thank you. And it says, and he who has what?
Ears.
Oh, come on now, church. Let's pay attention now. And he who has what?
Ears
to hear, let him be listening, and let him consider and perceive and comprehend by what?
Hearing.
By hearing. Amen? That's That's the foundation right there. That's where it's going to kick in. And then, with that being said, turn to Romans 10 and 17. Romans 10 and 17. And this ought to be a very familiar passage to most. Okay, everybody ready? So it says what? So faith comes by what is told. And what is heard comes by the preaching of the message that came from the lips of Christ, the Messiah himself. So you see how it has to be a working between us and that word so that we can get the results that we're looking for. Amen. So this is why Jesus went into his discourse of the parable of the seed and the sower. And this is what my little setup is all about this morning, folks. So this is going to be good. So I want you to pay attention. And I really hope and pray that we get something out of this. Okay. So first of all, there are four types of soils. You can go to that next one, Will. The next picture, please. Yes, sir. Thank you, Will. No, back one. Okay. So here's the four soils. We have the roadside, we have the rocky, we have the thorny, and then we have the good ground. So first we're going to focus on the roadside. Everybody say the roadside. See, the thing about it is, about roadside people is, when you hear the word of God, are you understanding the truth and the power and the magnitude of that word? See, the word is not going to benefit you if there is no understanding, if there is no comprehension, if there is no revelation that comes alive in your heart. See, the problem with roadside type things is this. So I'm just walking along the roadside and here comes the word. And the God begins to sow that word into my heart, but it just fell right there and didn't do a thing. Why? Because I didn't do anything with it. It's your responsibility to do something with the word. It's not my responsibility. It's everybody's responsibility to do and be accountable to what you hear. But a lot of times, roadside folks, they just come and they just kind of like the rocks there, just like the road there. The word comes and it just sits there and it does nothing. Now, how do you expect to benefit from the word when it just sits there? You didn't come to church ready for the word to do something within your heart. You just came because it's routine. Come on now. No condemnation, folks. I'm just loving on you now. That's why, folks, this is so dangerous. This is what the enemy loves. He loves a so-called believer that would come and just sit in the pew like they normally do, and then the man of God is throwing out the word to you, and it just sits there. That is a person who is not participating, thank you, Holy Ghost, in what the word is supposed to be doing in your life. You're just here, all the rocks are doing is just being a rock, just sitting there, showing themselves. And how many times people just come and they just sit here and they just want to show themselves? Come on now. Is that real talk? Okay, so watch this. When it comes to the word, folks, you have to understand that when I come in this house, the word that's going forth is not ordinary. But actually, the word is extraordinary. Oh, well, let me add another word. Actually, the word is supernatural. Oh, let me add something else. Actually, that word is the power of God manifested among us. And this is the word in which I must be ruled and regulated and governed by, y'all. Amen. See, here's the problem. Here's the problem. I've said this. I don't know how many times I've said this. But see, the word is not a democracy. We live in a democratic society, yes. But when it comes to how we're adhering to the word, that's not up for discussion. It's a theocracy, which means God has the final say-so, not you. So when the word is being tossed, does it have the final say-so? Does it have the final say-so, or when the word is tossed, you just say so? So what? Who cares? Isn't that truth? Is that what we're saying when it comes to the word of God? Now watch this. It is of no good use to for the word not to contribute to our understanding and for us to profit by what we're listening to. What you have to do is, if we're going to profit from the word, and I've heard pastors say this over and over, and I've heard various people say, if you're going to listen to the word, you have to hear it over and over and over and over and over again. See, if I have a plant, maybe some plants only need just a little bit of water, but most plants, you have to keep watering that thing over and over and over, and that's the word in your heart. You got to do it over and over and say it over and over until it takes root, and then it begins to bear the shoot and then the fruit eventually. But you can't just let it just sit there and not do anything. See, active listening alone is more of a self-centered conversation. If you're not actively listening, it's more self-centered conversation. Example, come on up here. My example. Now watch this.
Hey, yo.
What's up? What's good, girl? How you doing?
I'm right here.
I'm right here. This challenge.
How you been?
Oh, you know, just right here, just working hard. You know how we do it.
Yeah.
Yes, ma'am.
Well, since last time I saw you, so much stuff has happened.
Right.
You know.
Right.
Maybe that job that came through for me.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, you remember? Oh my gosh, that was just a blessing.
Girl, I'm so happy for you right now.
Thank you. Mm-hmm. But that's not all that happened. I mean, like, because I've been on that job about 8 months,
mm-hmm.
and I got Employee of the Month.
Oh, what, girl? You're the bomb, girl.
Thank you. Mm-hmm. And then on top of that, they were like, you know what? We're going to put you in for Employee of the Year. And guess what? Mm. I got it. I got Employee of the Year. Isn't that amazing?
I'm sorry?
I got Employee of the Year.
Oh.
Isn't that amazing?
Isn't God good?
Yeah.
Praise the Lord.
Oh, you know what? I got to get back to that job, but it was good seeing you.
Good to see you, boo.
Take care.
Peace. Okay, so you see, she was so excited about what was going on in her life, and me, I'm just sitting here and I'm half-heartedly listening to her. Now, I don't want to step on no toes, but wives, can any of the wives relate to sometimes that being, or husbands? Okay, don't raise your hands. Don't say nothing. I'm not trying to start no riot now, you know. But the point of it is this. She was excited about conveying what was in her heart, and I wasn't excited about receiving what was in her heart. And see, it's the same thing when we come into the house. See, the pastor is excited about conveying what's in his heart. And are we just as excited or ready or willing to receive what's being conveyed out of one person's heart so that I can get it into my heart? Hallelujah.
Amen.
See, that's why we have to be active participants when it comes to the word. And no condemnation, because watch this. You know, there's been times when I've been in church and somebody would be speaking and sometimes my mind wanders. I mean, but you know what? You got to call that joker right back and say, look, you need to be paying attention, dude. This man, and watch this. One thing that God wanted to plant into your heart that you needed, you missed it because your mind was elsewhere. Your mind was focused. I'm gonna put it on me because you know I don't want to. Sometimes my mind get focused on that chicken in the back, Rachel. Boy, they got fried chicken in that back. Oh boy, let me hurry. Come on, Pastor, wrap it up now. I want my fried chicken and my sweet potato pie. You know. Okay, that's real. Okay. Okay, isn't that true? That's true talk, right? But the thing about it is, then pastor say something and it's kind of like, what did he say? And thank God the man of God will repeat himself. And I'm like, Lord, that's exactly what I needed. And if I would have stayed, my mind would have stayed focused on the other thing, you know what I'm saying? Then I would have missed my blessing. And how many times we step inside the house over and over and over again just to miss your blessing when you was praying to God, oh God, you know I need a solution right now. I need an answer right now. But because your mind ain't focused on the word and you didn't come ready to receive the word, you done missed your blessing. You done missed your word. Because see, watch this. Thank you, Holy Ghost. See, the Spirit of God knows what you need. That's why when it comes, when we talked about it last week, Pastor, that's why I said we have to study this word. Because see, watch this, y'all. I'm accountable to every word that comes out of my mouth. I'm accountable to God for that. Same with pastor, any teacher, preach, whoever. We are accountable to God, and we're really almost at a higher standard because we're the one that say, well, God's, Pastor, I feel the Lord put it on my heart for me to teach. Okay. But you better be ready for the responsibility that comes with it. You better be ready for the warfare that comes with it. You better be ready for the times of prayer and fasting and everything else that comes with it. We just don't get up here, slam a couple of scriptures together, and talk about thus saith the Lord. And if you're doing that, then I'm going to tell you need to sit down. And if I'm doing it, I need to sit down. And there's been times when I have done it. And thank God the man of God recognized it. And he said, look, dude, you need to get yourself together. I thank God, I used to be mad. Boy, I was madder than a hornet when he first said it. But I'm like, man, who he think he is? He think he missed the preacher, you know, but I can preach too, you know. I got something to say. Well, say to yourself, sit your butt down. That's what you need to say. Okay. So moving on. So that's why our listening to the truth can't be half-hearted, folks. Are we getting this? Okay? If we want to talk about real revival in our hearts, it cannot be halfway listening. Amen? Now what?
Faith comes by hearing.
That's right. Faith comes by hearing.
Just hear half of it, you get half faith.
That's good, Pastor. Did y'all hear the pastor on that one? So if you have hearing, you only get half the faith. But I don't want the half. I want the whole. See, if I'm going to get a piece of pie, then I want the whole slice. I don't want a half a slice. I want the whole slice of pie. Amen? Amen, 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 amen. That's why I told Miss Rachel, I said, when you make that, what is that, chicken pot pie or whatever that thing is? Now, don't be half-stepping on me now. I want the whole thing right there. Bam, 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 on my plate. And me and Charles will be in the back, you know. Yo, pie. Okay. Now watch this. Okay, now listen to this, folks. Okay. The word is the seed sown, which, watch this. When it's first sown, the seed is dry. Y'all got it? But watch this. But everything that is inside the seed is inside the seed. See, it might look dead. Oh, thank you, Holy Ghost. See, some people think that that's why we can't judge one another. Thank you, Holy Ghost. We'll do it like that. Thank you, Lord. See, that's why we can't judge one another because, see, you think that person's life is dry and that person's life is dead and of no value. But the Holy Ghost is saying, but there's something that I placed inside that particular person, amen, that once it gets into the right environment for growth, then that joker's going to take off like a rocket, amen. It's going to grow like a mighty oak. Amen. So don't ever down yourself. Don't ever think that you're disqualified. Don't ever think that you're good enough. Amen. Because God is putting something on the inside of you. And once you get it in the right environment, thank you, Holy Ghost, it's going to produce. Amen.
Amen.
But you can't just let the word fall on you like a rock. It's not going to do anything. Amen. So you got to challenge your heart today and say, am I one of those rocky type soil Christians? No condemnation, but just something to think about. Amen. Now watch this. Man's heart is like the soil. It's capable of improvement. It's capable of bearing fruit. But watch this. It's a pity. And this is from Matthew Henry. So I'm just kind of reading from some of his commentary. He says, it's a pity if the seed is sown and we're slothful with our seed. Whew. Did y'all hear that? He said, when the seed is sown, it's a pity that we're lazy and not allowing or doing what we have to do to cultivate the seed because we're so lazy in the spirit. Come on now. Hallelujah. We got to get from out of see, again, I said last week, I told y'all, see, the enemy is not playing out here, y'all. He is real about what he's talking about. He's real about what he's doing. He has a mission. He knows his time is short. And think about it. Night and day, this Joker is on the move. Night and day and day and night. And he is not stopping. He is not slowing down. He is not quitting. But yet we have the spirit of life. We have the resurrection power within us. And I too am sometimes as guilty. But then I allow my laziness and my contentment, my being content, cause me not to put in the work that I need so the word can work with inside me. Amen. You got to put in some work. Touch your neighbor and say, it's time to work. Come on, touch your neighbor now. Tell him it's time to work. You got to work that word, baby. We got to work it, y'all. Don't let it fall on deaf ears. I remember my mama used to say stuff like that. Boy, don't let my talking to you fall on deaf ears. Don't let it be so, church. Watch this. See, Jesus, see, there may be all types of different soils. Hallelujah. We talked about the different types of soil, but watch this. Jesus only gave one type of seed. Amen. And that seed was the word of the kingdom. See, when the king speaks, the kingdom and his word prospers. Amen. I'm going to say that one more time. When the king speaks, the king and his kingdom word will prosper in your life. As a matter of fact, put up there, Brother Willie, Isaiah chapter 55, verse 10. Isaiah 55 and 10. Hallelujah. Miss Rachel, would you mind reading for me, please? Thank you, ma'am. I get so frustrated taking all my glasses, putting it on. I'm just like, you know what? I'm taking them off. I got to get me some contacts. Okay, go ahead, ma'am. I'm sorry.
For as the rain and snow come down from the heavens,
yes,
and return not there again,
mm-hmm,
but water the earth,
mm-hmm,
and make it bring forth and sprout,
mm-hmm,
that it may give seed to the sower,
uh-huh,
and bread to the eater.
Uh-huh. And verse 11, please. Go ahead.
So shall my word be that goes forth, mm-hmm, out of my mouth.
Uh-huh.
It shall not return to me void.
Right.
Without producing any effect, useless,
okay, mm-hmm,
but it shall accomplish that which I please and purpose,
mm-hmm,
and it shall prosper in the thing for which I sent it.
Now, is that powerful or what? I mean, that speaks all for itself, church. The word will work. But you got to get it from this stage where you're just, so when the word comes and it's just, we can't be like that, y'all. God's word will do what it says will do. And as a matter of fact, I love that message that Phil taught a couple of Wednesday nights, and I would recommend you to get that, where he talked about the confession of your mouth. We just read that, and in Romans, that faith comes by and hearing the word. So that's why he says, when my word goes out, it's going to do something. It's going to be effective. It's going to cause change. But the thing about it is, do you want your heart to change? Do you want your mind to be renewed? You see, sometimes those are the questions that we really need to ask ourselves. And be real with ourselves. Because again, we all have areas in our hearts. I got them. Everybody has things in their heart where your mind got to be renewed. I said this last week. And you have to deal with some of these things. But you put the word on it. Keep putting the word on it. My brother came to me talking about, you know, I'm feeling a little anxious right now. Put the word on it. Peace. 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 You know, if it wasn't for the word, thank you, Holy Ghost. If it wasn't for the word, I wouldn't even be standing in front of you. But what you're seeing in front of you this morning is the word working. Yeah. Woo! Thank you, Holy Ghost. Thank you, Holy Ghost. What you're seeing is the word in action right in front of you, because it took the word to bring me out of that grave, to resurrect this boy from the deep pit of darkness back into the marvelous light. That's why I know the word works. That's why I know I can speak this thing with confidence, because I've seen it work in my own life. Amen. I'm not telling you something that I ain't experienced. I experienced this for myself. And because the man of God and the woman of God who was full of the word took the word and poured the word, and then I received the word, I ate the word, I was hungry for the word, and it brought new life to that which the man was talking about here. The seed may have been dead at first, but then it put into the right counseling environment right here, mom and pop. Here you go. The word at work, amen. Glory to God, amen. And I'm not saying that to say look at me, but if you're going to look at me, look at the example that was shown to me, and let me be an example to you. Because just like I don't see the sister, but just like I told the sister the other day, I told him, I said, if I can do it, anybody can do it. If I can stand, anybody can stand. If I can have that glory, Jesus smile on my face, anybody can do it. So I don't think nobody has an excuse, Pastor. I don't think so. Because I know what time it is, and if I can do it, you better be able to do it. You ought to be doing it. Amen? So we good on that one, right? Y'all ready to take it in? Can we go deeper? Okay, watch this now. Some of you might say, well, you know what, Will? I mean, I hear all this stuff you talk. I hear all this that you're talking, and I agree with you. I think it's good. I want to receive it. But how come the word isn't prospering in my life? Why isn't the word benefiting in my life? What is going on? And sometimes, have you ever thought that before? Why is it what I'm believing not prospering in my life? Well, one of the things could be, do you come prepared, watch this, ready to receive the good of God's seeds? Okay, so that what? Your heart can be changed and your mind can be renewed. See, there's good inside the word, and you have to mine that stuff out. Just like going in the deep of the caves and getting the diamonds and the jewelry and all that, you got to mine that stuff out. So when the word comes to you, you got to mine it out. You got to dig it out. You got to wrestle it out. You got to keep getting it and saying it and speaking it. Until it does something, until there's a chain react, till something happens in your life, and then the word becomes flesh. and begins to dwell in your heart and in your mind and in your spirit. Amen. Amen. Oh, I'm feeling good this morning, church. I'm feeling good this morning, church. Amen. Because I'm being blessed because I'm speaking the word and my faith is being built up as I'm speaking. Amen. I'm getting excited as I'm speaking. Amen. Because the word is going forth and I'm hearing the word. Amen. And it's doing something in me right now. Amen. I'm getting excited. Amen. Because I know the truth. And they always said the truth shall set you free. So come ready to get the good of God's seeds, okay? And if you're not hearing the word, then you can't hold on to the word. You can't hold on to what you're not hearing. That's why when sis was talking to me and she was so excited, just wanting me wanted somebody to grab a hold of what she grabbed a hold of, I couldn't grab it. It was just like trying to grasp the wind because I wasn't prepared. I wasn't actively involved, so I couldn't hold on to the words that were coming out of her mouth. Now, watch it with God. It's the same thing with the word of God. It's the same thing with God. When he speaks, are you holding on to the word? Amen. Are you? Are we? You got to hold on to that thing tight. I know I did. I had to. Amen. Okay, so if you come now, here's the good side. Let me lighten it up. Here's the good side. So if you come into the house of God and you say, "Look, Willie, I hear what you're saying, and I really want to try to understand what you're saying, but I'm just having a hard time understanding." Sometimes we just don't understand the truth. Sometimes we just don't, certain things we don't understand. Okay. Well, here's the answer to all that. Then what you ought to be doing is you ought to be asking questions. You ought to be researching that particular subject. You ought to be getting books related to that subject. You ought to be praying and meditating on that subject. You see? And this is how we begin to get the revelation. For an example, I'll just tell y'all how it happens to me. Pastor said, "Okay, son, you ready to preach?" "Yes, sir, Pastor." And then I said, "Oh, Lord, I don't know what you want me to talk about, but what do you want me to talk about?" And I just kind of sit, and I just sit until something hits me, you know? And then once it hits me, like the parable of the soils, then I'm like, okay. And then what I do is, Lord, let me read upon what this story is all about. So then I go and I read it. And then I might read it again. And then I might read it again. And I might read it again. And then watch this. As I'm reading, then little things begin to pop out about the scripture. "Oh, well, I never seen that part, Miss Rachel, about the soil." Or, "You know, Mr. Floyd, I didn't realize that, you know, when he was talking about the soil, that's what he was talking about." See, and so therefore, see, I'm doing my due diligence. And this is how we got to approach the word, y'all. Do your due diligence so that you can get the most good out of what you're trying to get from out the scripture. Amen. It's there. Thank you, Holy Ghost. It's there for the taking. See, if a pastor said, well, son, I didn't see you in Sunday school class this morning. I said, "Yeah, Pastor, you know, I'm just trying to, you know, meditate, you know, get myself together." He said, "Man, you missed it. We were giving out $1,000 bills." I was like, "Oh, man, I won't miss the next one." But if there was a whole crowd and somebody said, okay, well, I'll give you this example. Watch this. Okay, I remember one time we went to MegaFest with T.D. Jakes. Oh, man, if you've never been to MegaFest, you need to check that out. Okay, so, and whether you like the sister or not, I think she's a real woman of God because I've actually seen it for myself. Juanita Bynum. Anybody ever heard of Juanita Bynum? This sister is no, y'all talk about fire. Oh my goodness, that sister is bad. Big ups to Juanita Bynum if you ever see this. Okay, so watch this. So she was up on the stage, and she was walking around and whatever, and this is why I knew that sister was anointed, okay? So she was up on the stage just kind of walking and praying, getting herself together, right? And me and my two friends that were with me at the time, we were walking around the dome, whatever, and we kind of looked and we said, oh, well, Juanita Bynum's getting ready to come on. So what we did is we walked around to where our seats was. And as soon as we walked into the stadium, man, it's like we walked into something. And we just began to weep. I mean, we were weeping, I don't even know what I was crying about, but I just knew I stepped into something. You know what I mean? So she begins to preach, and I mean, the power of God is just, ooh, it's almost mind blowing. You know what I mean? So watch this. So she has the stage lined up with all these prayer shawls and she's preaching and whatever. And I don't know what led her to say this. And I was just like, I was so surprised she said it, but she said, if any of you want a prayer shawl, come on up and get it. And I'm telling you now, we were on the nosebleed section. You can see this whole crowd of people just running towards, I mean, rushing the stage. And I remember I saw one a white gentleman. He ran, and that joker dove. he said, I'm getting one of those prayer shawls. But he ran, I'm telling you the truth, church, and he dove on the stage and grabbed it and wrapped himself. And I mean, all kind of people's rushing the stage. Now watch this. Now let me show you how the enemy works. So obviously, I don't think she would have said that unless the Lord told her to, but I mean, I don't know, you know, what was going on with her. But at the same time, while somebody's being blessed to receive the prayer shawl, the enemy reared his head and somebody attacked her. And let me tell you something, and I knew, and it was definitely hellish, because I'm telling you, this joker was no bigger than a nickel. I mean, this joker was thin and he was skinny and scrawny, and he attacked her. So immediately all the security guards came and took him up. And I'm telling you, it took five of them big, I mean, there were some big bodyguards. I mean, football player looking jokers. It took like five or six of them to carry off this dude that was only this big. So, you know, there's always a price to this word, y'all. And we got to pay the price. It just ain't going to happen by osmosis or any of those other things. But I know that sister is one who prays, who studies, who digs into the word. And I mean, the power of God is on her life, even to this day, when I just recently saw her on TV. But she's not a que sera sera type listener. She is an active listener of the Word of God and has been standing in the truth for many years. So I just wanted to say that. But here's the truth of the matter. If you're not getting the good out of the soil, if you're out of the seed and you're allowing the seed just to sit on top of you like a rock, then guess what? It's not my fault. I know that's bold, but it's not the pastor's fault. It's not the teacher's fault that you're not getting the good out of the word. Amen. See, it's your responsibility to do something to get this word from wherever you need to get it from, to get it in the real rich, good soil of your heart so that it can take root and grow. And I think that all God is saying in essence is, I want y'all to grow. I think that's all he's just really saying, you know. He says, I understand if your heart's kind of rocky, I understand that. But I made a provision for that. And we'll talk about the good news out of all the soils, but it's no condemnation. There's nothing that makes you feel bad, as pastors are always talking about. Just if you're saying that you're not comprehending or understanding or getting the good out of the word, then do something about it. Be like Nike and just do it. Amen? Okay. Let me see where we are. Okay, let's move on to the next. Let me make sure I'm good on my time. Okay, I got some time. Okay, good. So we're going to move on to the next soil. But one last point I want to say before we move to the stony ground. We're going to move to the stony ground is, have we grown accustomed to putting on and off when it comes to our faith? That I'm spiritual when I want to be spiritual, but then when I don't want to be spiritual, I'm not. Come on now, it's real talk now. No condemnation, just a question. Because if my faith, if I'm so quick to put my faith on and take it off, then eventually my root system, thank you, Holy Ghost, is going to get damaged. See, you can't take a plant and put it in the ground, then take it out, and then just keep doing this back and forth. How will it even grow? How can it take root if you keep putting it in and taking it out? And sometimes that's what we do with our faith. We'll put it on, and then we'll take it off, and then we put it on, and then we take it off, and then we put it on, and then we take it off. And you wonder why you can't even get anything from out the word. You can't get anything from out the soil because you're not in there long enough for it to do something. Amen? So and that's what happens when seed is sown on the wayside. Amen. Now let's move to the stony ground, and then we'll everybody getting something out of this? Amen. Everybody good? Okay. Thank you, Lord. Okay, now watch this. So now we're talking about the stony ground. Okay, here we go. Let me make sure I got it. Okay, so the stony ground is the one where the seed, where's my stony ground? Okay. So the seed is sown, and there's something beginning to grow there. But do you notice something about the growth here? Okay, it's dead. It's dry. And what else? One other thing I'm looking for. Okay, it's small. That's good. What? One more other thing. Okay, y'all give up? Okay, I'm sorry. There is no depth of root. You see that? You see how it's just sitting there on top? Can everybody see that? But there is no depth. There's no depth of a root system there. So I wonder why it's dry. I wonder why it's kind of crunchy and brown looking and like it's on its last leg. Because it's on stones, stony soil. So what? Thank you, Holy Ghost. So watch this. So when the word comes to your heart and it springs up, it looks promising. It looks productive. It looks like it's doing something. But then as you begin to delve underneath it, you see there's no root system in which to draw its nourishment from. See, a lot of times we receive the word and we receive it with gladness. We receive it with happiness. We receive it with joy. And that's a good thing because at least we're not by the wayside. So you receive the word and you're all excited and you're like, man, I'm going to do something with that. And immediately it does spring and it does grow and it does begin to activate. But it's growing up. But a tree grows two ways, up and down. So how deep is that word getting into your heart? Do you, thank you, Holy Ghost, do you have a sustainable root system in the word that will produce growth? real growth, in-depth growth. See, thank you, Holy Ghost. See, Paul said, you know what? I can't talk to y'all as spiritual because y'all still drinking the milk. And if you've been a Christian, and again, no condemnation, but if you've been a Christian for a certain amount of time, Paul says that all the elementary things you already ought to know. And I bet you if I read what those elementary things are, probably me included, some of those things would be like, well, gosh, I'm still kind of in grade school on that one. Man, he got me on that one, Pastor. And I mean, again, no condemnation. We all have places and areas which we got to grow. But some things, like pastors, I've heard pastors say, some things ought to be fundamental. This is what we're going to build up on. Amen. And we're going to begin to grow. But this is what happens if the word comes and yet our hearts are hardened and rocky. You know, when I work, or at least the other crew I used to work on, before we would lay the sod, what we would have to do is we all have to rake the soil and get out all the roots and stuff. And we rake all that stuff out and rake it out. And then we go back and then we rake it again to make sure everything is good and the soil is level, so that when the sod is laid, even though the sod is laid like this in chunks, but when it's put on the ground, because we cleared all the rocks out the way, it's conducive now so that it can go ahead and generate a good root system and that grass can begin to grow. Green grass, amen? And sometimes when we put the sod down, thank you, Lord, sometimes when we put it down, it's brown just like this. And I'm like, now how is that going to live? But again, once you get all the rocks out the way and you clear the soil and you water it and you keep going what needs to keep going to keep the thing moving, then eventually when the summertime or the springtime comes, you're going to start to see green coming up. So when God looks at your heart, is he seeing brown or is he seeing green coming up? When the word is sown into your heart, does it turn out brown or is it green, turning green, 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 green in your heart? Amen? But we have to be careful. We got to be careful that we just let the word just lay by the wayside and just say, like, so what? And then we got to be careful about the stony soils of our hearts. Amen? This is, see the thing about sown, a stony heart, it's a stubborn heart. It's a hard heart. And God didn't call us to have hardened hearts. See, sometimes, thank you, Lord. See, this is the deception of the enemy. See, the enemy would get us in situations to make us think that we're doing a good thing, but actually it's hardening our hearts. Amen. Okay, I'll put it on me, okay? I don't mind. I remember I had a situation with a sister one time, and the sister kept saying, well, you know, hey, look, man, you know, we ain't got to do nothing. You just come on over to the crib. You can chill. We can eat. I'll fix you something to eat, you know what I'm saying? We're just going to cool out, you know? But then something in my mind kept saying, in my heart saying, you know what, dude? I don't think you should be going over there, man. I don't think it's a good thing, Will, you know. So watch this. So I'm like grappling with it. And I said, well, yeah, man, Lord, you know, I'm sick of sitting at home by myself. You know what I mean, man? Come on, man. I mean, I'm just going to eat dinner and then I'm out. I'm going to get my grub on and I'm gone. Right? But the Lord kept messing with me, Mom, and kept saying, son, I just didn't feel peace about doing it. Right? So eventually I already convinced myself that I'm going to do it. I'm going over there. I'm just going to grab me a plate of food, like I said, and then I'm gone. So, and I said, and you know what? I'll surprise her. I'll drop by, get a little piece of pie or, you know, get a little something, and then I'll just come on over, right? So, this is a true story now. This is a true story. So, watch this, Miss Carol. Boy, you know, mama say hard head makes soft behind. Yes. Okay, well, let me show you how my behind got soft, okay? So should I be? Oh, I'm sorry, little kids. I keep forgetting. Okay, forgive me. Y'all know what I'm talking. Y'all know what I mean, right? I forget. Okay, so I go over there. I got the pie. I go over to the girl's house, right? And so I pull up next to her apartment. And then I just sit for a sec. I just say, sit for a second. I know, what am I sitting here? Why don't I just go on in the house, right? And I'm just like sitting, right? And then next thing you know, I see this cat coming out her back door. And watch this. True story, y'all. My hand to the Lord. I ain't gonna lie. He coming out there like this. I mean, buck naked as a jaybird, walking through the grass. I said, oh, heck. I didn't say heck. Sorry. Forgive me, Lord. But I said, oh, no. And I was about to get up and jump. And I was going, you know how we do it. But I said, well, wait a minute. Lord said, wait a minute. Didn't I tell you why you shouldn't even have been coming over there? And you didn't seem, and you know, that sister kind of didn't seem like kind of the spiritual woman that you was looking for off the top. And now you see why. So I just wanted to see what the sister was going to say. So I still walked up to the door. I know I'm being, you know, yeah, see, I got the thumbs up. See, so I walked up to the door. Oh, yo, what's up, girl? How you doing? You know, what you got fixed for me? And I acted like nothing was going on. Everything was cool. Okay. So if she's acting like that now, what would happen later on down the road? And though it may have appeared to have been a good thing, but it wouldn't have produced the results that I wanted. And sometimes the enemy, but watch this though, before I get to that point, thank you, Lord. But see, I hardened my heart and went on and bucked the system, bucked the Holy Ghost, bucked the word that was already screaming one thing in my heart. But because I hardened my heart, I wanted to do what the other thing that I wanted to do, hardened my heart. But thank God for his hedge of protection that still, even in his grace and mercy, still went on ahead. And I found out what the kind of girl, what the girl was really all about. You see what I'm saying? But I hardened my heart, and then that which I really wanted wouldn't have came to pass if I even hardened my heart even more to the Holy Ghost. So you see how critical it is for all of us to be sensitive to the Holy Spirit. But sometimes the enemy will try to put us in a position, again, to make us seem like it's okay, make it seem like it's a good thing. But in the reality, it's only hardening your heart. So when the word comes, and because your heart is hard, look at the results that you're going to get. Oh, I hear you, Pastor. God, praise God. Bam, you know, you got your soil on the top. But then when the missus come home and say, well, honey, let's break open that word. Or, honey, would you pray for me? Or, hey, baby, would you mind rubbing my feet? And there ain't no root system there. Rub your own feet. Fix your own dinner. Rub your own back. Wait a minute. Love your wife as Christ loved the church. Where is that root system? You see? That's why we can't allow the word to just come and just sit on top of our hard hearts. And we all got it in an area. If the word's going to be effective, just like what we do in the natural, first the natural, then the spiritual, I got to rake away all those rocks. I got to remove all those stones so that when the word and when the seed is planted and the water comes and the rain comes and all the things that helps produce green grass, the environment needed for growth, and when it comes, and when I'm placed inside of that, I'm gonna get some fresh, green grass. Amen. So we only dealt with two soils today, and I mean, and I still got a little bit more that we'll talk about next week, but it's getting a little late. So we will continue with the stony heart, but you got to ask yourself, is the word just fallen by the wayside when it's sown? Or when the word is sown, it's sown on in stony ground. You got to decide. Amen. So let's everybody bow your heads. Let's pray. We'll close it out. Okay. Father, in the name of Jesus, Lord, I just want to just thank you again for this awesome opportunity. And Lord, I'm truly humbled, Lord. Father, you know that I love this people, Lord. And I'm not saying that to show off, Father God. In the depths of my heart, I truly love this church, and I truly love my church family, Father. And Lord, you know that in all of our hearts, Father, when the word is sown, sometimes we just let it fall by the wayside. And the word never does anything. That's because so many times, Lord, we come not prepared to receive the good out of your word. And then, Lord, maybe for some of us, we have a stony heart, Lord. We just have hard hearts, Lord. But there's a remedy for that, Father God. So, Lord, whatever way, whatever heart that we're grappling with, Father God, if it's by the wayside, let's get it from the wayside and get it to the place where it can become good. And if we're grappling with hard-heartedness, Father God, Lord, let's take that rake called the Holy Ghost and the rake called the Word, Father God, and let's clear out, Father God, some stones this week, Lord. Because, Lord, it's important that we have a functioning, thank you, Lord, a functioning root system when it comes to the Word, Father. Again, Lord, we'll talk a little bit more about the stony heart next week, Father God, and move on to the other soils, Father. But I pray, Lord, let's not let this word fall and not produce, Lord. It's not about me, Lord. I'm just a puppet. I'm just a messenger, Father. But I'm a messenger that I know I love everyone whom my eyes behold in this crowd. And if we have to hear that word over and over, may we do it. And right now, if anyone says, well, Lord, I'm one of the two, or I'm both of them, or whatever, I just want to give you an opportunity. Just say a little prayer to the Lord right now, and then I'll have Pastor come and close it out. But just say a little prayer right now, church. Because it's not like God don't know anyways. He knows the condition of our hearts. But I believe he also knows where we want to be, where we truly desire to be. So take a faith, thank you, Lord. Take a faith step this morning, church, and say, I'm going to move from this soil, and I'm going to move to that soil. I'm going to move from dead and dryness to being one that's going to flourish. I'm going to get it from off the wayside, and I'm going to study it and make a fresh commitment to the Lord, church. You make a fresh commitment to God about how you want the word to work in your life. Father, you see the hearts, you see the minds, you see the lives, Lord. And you know what you're wanting to do. So I touch, come here for a second, Pastor. First Lady, y'all both come up here. Pastor, yeah. And I just want to, me and Pastor, as we hold hands, yeah, we're just touching and agreeing by faith for all of us that we would be who you desire us to be and who you want us to be, Father. We ask this now. Come on, First Lady. We ask this. We touch and we agree on this thing, Pastor.
Yes. Father, we thank you right now for the word of God that's come out.